Hello everyone, welcome to the seventh lecture on the course Mathematic Modeling and Simulation. So in this lecture we will develop some population growth model and then we will do few questions that will tell us how the number of individuals in a population increases or decreases with time. So let's begin. First we will see the geometric growth. For this, let us assume that at time t is equal to 0, we have a population size n naught. And if we want to see the ratio of the population size change in 1 year to the size of the preceding year, let this be denoted by lambda. Now, if at time t I have a population size of nt, and then what will be the population size at time t plus 1? This will be equal to this, as the ratio between the two consecutive year population is lambda. So you can see that I can write the population at time t plus 1 is equal to population at time t into lambda. Now if you put t is equal to 0 over here, what you will get? You will get n1 is equal to n0 into lambda. Now similarly, if I put t is equal to 1 in this formula, you will get n2 is equal to n1 into lambda. Now you can see that over here n1 is what? n0 into lambda. So I can put the value of n1 over here and I will get this. So n2 is ultimately in the terms of n0. If I know this n0 only, then you can see that n2 can be written as n0 into lambda square and so on. So if at any time I am interested to find out the population, this will be equal to n0 into lambda to the power t. As you can see that this index will go over here. So if I know the population at n0, this one is known, I know the ratio of the population size between two consecutive year, that is lambda, I can find out the population for any time. So this represents the geometric growth model. And if I draw the graph of this, as you can see that this one is a discrete model, and if you consider this as a year time, then if you can see that I am getting the information at the distance or at a gap of 1 year. And if I plot the graph, it will look like this, which is similar to the exponential growth. So this one is done taking n0 is equal to 100 and lambda is taken to be 1.5. And if you draw a graph in the logarithmic scale, you can see that how the population is increasing in the logarithmic scale. Now it is obvious that if my lambda is greater than 1, then the population will increase. If lambda is equal to 1, we will have a constant population size, and if the lambda value is in between 0 to 1, there will be a decreasing population. So now first we will see the definition of exponential growth and decay model. We are moving towards the continuous model. A quantity y is equal to yt is said to be of exponential growth if it increases at the rate that is proportional to the amount of quantity present, and it is said to have a exponential decay if it decreases at the rate that is proportional to the amount of quantity present. Now if I want to write it mathematically, you can see that I can write dy by dt is equal to r into y. This is saying that the population rate increases with the quantity present. So this one is a exponential growth model. And if I talk about exponential decay model, this will be dy by dt minus of r into y. And here in both these models, r is greater than 0. So here you can see that there is increase that is proportional to the quantity present, and here it decreases at the which is proportional to the amount of quantity present. And if I talk about this r is a growth constant or the decay constant as appropriate. Here it is acting as a growth constant, here it is acting as a decay constant. Moving further, ecologists expressed the instantaneous population growth using calculus, and they considered that the rate of population growth is proportional to the population or the number, as I have shown you the equation. And if I consider the closed population, that means that there will be no immigration and no emigration. That means that the border is closed, or it is also possible that the rate of immigration will be equal to the rate of emigration. So the population size change is related only to what? The birth rate and the death rate. And if we calculate the difference between the birth rate and the death rate, which gives us the intrinsic growth rate, and I can write R is equal to B minus D. And therefore, if I consider this N as a population size and this B as a birth rate and D as a per capita death rate, then the rate of change of the population over a small period of time will be equal to B minus D, that is ultimately equal to R into N, that is intrinsic growth rate. And this R is intrinsic growth rate. So firstly, we have seen that this one is our differential equation. Now if we solve this differential equation, we will get our solution like this. And since the solution contains this exponential term, this is referred to as exponential growth model. So here also you can see that if you know this R and the population initially, then you can calculate the population, that is nt, for any time. Now this model considers some assumptions. So this one is initial population is small, no food or resource limitation, and as we have seen that the geometric growth population was in the discrete time interval, and this if we talk about this exponential growth model, it is continuous model, or it gives us the population at all the time. Now this one is an example of the exponential growth model which is seen in the nature. If we see the reindeer population, they have only 4 males and 22 females in 1910, but in 1940 it was observed that it became nearly 2000. So it is showing a exponential kind of growth. So this was one of the example for a species showing the exponential growth from the nature. So this exponential model have some kind of limitations because it describes the population in an idealized unlimited environment. It assumes that the species can grow unlimited, but this is not a true case. Then we will derive other models which are more realistic than this exponential growth rate. And we also see that the intrinsic growth rate which was symbolized by R is B minus D. And here also, if R is greater than 0, that means population is growing, and if R is less than 0, then population is declining. So if R is greater than 0, this means that the birth rate is greater than the death rate, and organisms has enormous potential to increase their population if not constrained by mortality. And any organism could then swarm the planet in a short time if reproduced without restraint. So this is a meaning when R is greater than 0. And if we see in the long term, our planet will be covered with the species, but it is obviously not true. And if we talk about the zero population growth, then this means that our R should be equal to 0. Now we are interested in finding a population, like we have the data about at initial we have a population of 300 and we see that our intrinsic growth rate is 0.5. Then the question is, after 5 years, what will be the population size? And you know that we have the solution of our exponential growth model as this. So just what we have to do, we have to put t is equal to 5 over here, as here the rate is given in per year. So here R we can put over here as 0.5 into t. T will be the time 5 years and n naught. So here you can see that I will put the value of n naught as 300 into, and if you can see, you will find the population after 5 years equal to this much. So this is the power of the models or the solutions of the model, you can have some predictions about the things beforehand. Now, let us interpret the growth rate and the decay constant. So if we talk about the significance of the constant R, this can be understood by seeing the differential equations I have shown you. Well, I can write my R as this, right? Because it was dy by dt is equal to R into y, and if I take this, it can be rewritten and R could be found as this. So if I talk about this R growth rate, it is that the growth rate as a fraction of the entire population remains constant over time, and this constant is R. And for this reason, R is called as relative growth rate of the population, and it is usual to express the relative growth rate as a percentage. So if I say the relative growth rate of 3% per unit of time in an exponential growth model, this means my R will be equal to 0.03. And similarly, R in the exponential decay case is called as relative decay rate. Now let us see one example. This is saying that according to UN, or you can say United Nations data, the world population in 1998 was approximately 5.9 billion, and the growing rate was about 1.33% per year. Assuming an exponential growth model, we need to estimate the population at the beginning of the year 2023. We need to find out the population. Now we will see the data, what it is given. It is given that in the beginning of 1998, the population was 5.9. So we will consider it as our t is equal to 0. So 1998 will correspond to my value t is equal to 0, and we will see, we will put initial condition as y naught is 5.9 billion. Now according to the given question, the growth rate is 1.33% per year, right? So I will consider my R as this, and I will put all the values in my exponential growth model. Now the last thing we need to do is that we need to find out the value of the population at 2023. So if you can see, if I minus 2023 with 1998, I will get 25 years. So we want to know what will be the population after 25 years. So here I will put t is equal to 25 in this equation, and then you can find out the value will be around 8.2 billion. At the beginning of the year 2023, we can say that there will be approximately 8.2 billion of population. Now we will talk about the doubling time and half life. What is this? So if you consider a quantity y has a exponential growth model, then the time required for the original size to double is called as doubling time. So I hope it is clear that if we have a exponential growth model and the time required for the original size to double its size is called as doubling time, and similarly y has an exponential decay model, and then the time required for the original size to reduce by half is called as half life. So this was the definition of a doubling time and a half life. So now we are interested to take out doubling time and half life. So if we have a exponential growth, we will have this solution. Now we will say that let t denote the amount of time required for y to double in size. We will say like capital T denote the time required for y to double in its size. So mathematically my T will be equal to capital T, in which I assumed that my quantity will be doubled. So my y will become what? It will become 2 times of y naught, and hence if I put this in my solution over here, like this is my solution of the exponential growth model, and if I put c, y is equal to y2y naught, that means that I am starting with quantity y naught, and this y will become 2 times y naught, means double of this. So I am interested in what? Finding this capital T. So I can see that this and this are getting cancelled, and I can write as this exponential to the power RT is equal to 2. If we take the natural log both the side, this will yield the equation as this, and here you can find out my time, which was the doubling time, will be equal to natural log 2 divided by R. So this one is a doubling time. Now you can also verify that this one is a half life of exponential decay also. This one is a time of doubling time, and this one is a time for the half life of exponential decay also. So by this, what you can find another thing is that this formula does not depend on initial size, or you can say initial amount. Why not? That means whatever amount we have, it will have the same doubling time or the same half lifetime, and it doesn't depend upon the initial amount. Why not? So let us illustrate this with a figure. So you can find out that here I have drawn a exponential graph, and this one you can observe from the time that this one is y naught, this one is 2y naught, this one is double of 2y naught, and this one is double of 4y naught. So what I am trying to say is that, see, the time of doubling is same. Like from y naught, if I want to see that when it will become 2y naught, when it will double, it is taking time capital T. You can see from the graph it is taking this much time. Now if I have a amount 2y naught, then it is taking the same time to double itself, right? From 2y it is becoming 4y in the same time t. And from 4y naught, if I can see that at what time it will double itself, it is again the same, that is t. So the formula, that is this formula, you can see is free of my, you can say, the initial amount. In the similar case of exponential decay, you can see that if I start with this, and if I want to see the time at which it becomes half, that is half of y naught, you can see that I have time t in which it is becoming half. The same time is taken to decrease from y naught by 2 to y naught by 4, that is half of this quantity. It is taking the same time. Again, if I want to see that when this quantity will become half, so you can see that it will take the same time. So this also is free of the initial quantity. Now, if I talk about the United Nations population, that example, and there it was given that the growth rate was 1.33% per year. Now, if we want to see what will be the doubling time of the population, then we can see that here my doubling time, if I use the formula of the doubling time, it is what? Natural log 2 by R. So this R is 1.33%. per year. So if I put over here, this means that the doubling time will be approximately 52 years. That means what? If the population at 1998 was 5.9 billion, it will double to 1.8 billion by how much year? 1998 plus 52 years. That means that at 2050, our population will double from 1998. And if I take this as my initial point and then see that when the population will double again, then it will double again by 2102 years. So it will double again to 23.6 billion. So these were the applications of finding the doubling time or half-life. Now we will see the applications of period doubling time and period halving for the case of a radioactive decay. So it is a fact in the physics that the radioactive element degenerates spontaneously, and this process is called as radioactive decay. And many experimentation have shown that the rate of disintegration is proportional to the amount of element which is present. So it is considered that every radioactive element have a specific half-life. And for example, if we talk about the half-life of radioactive carbon 14, it is considered to be 5730 years. So it is particularly for the carbon 14 we have the half-life as 5730 years. So if we are interested in calculating the decay constant, because here we know the time, that is half-life, we know that it is 5730 years. So we can calculate the decay constant. How we can calculate? It's simple. I have taken decay constant with the symbol K, and as you know that I have derived the time as ln 2 by R. So I have written R as K to represent the decay constant. So this I will bring over here, so it will become, now since T we know that it is 5730, our decay constant will become this much approximately. Now what does this tells? This tells that if there are Y naught units of carbon 14 present at time T0, that is at initial time, if this much amount is present, then the amount that is present after T years will be approximately what? It will be approximately this much, right? You know Y naught. This is already calculated from here, and after T years you can easily see that how many carbon 14 elements are present. So we will do one example on this. Suppose that we have 100 grams of radioactive carbon 14 are stored in a cave for 1000 years. Now how many grams will be left at that time? This is the question. It means that if 100 grams of radioactive carbon 14 are stored in a cave for past 1000 years, then how many grams will be left at the present time? So that means that we are given that Y naught was 100 grams, and we want to see that after 1000 years, if I count this as my initial reference, that this was my time t is equal to 0, from that I have gone 1000 years, and the initial quantity was how much? It was 100 grams. So y 1000 will be equal to this, which I have calculated. Like this one is for carbon 14, the rate of decay of carbon 14 we have calculated in the previous slide. So here I will just use that, and then I will just put y naught as 100. This one is e to the power minus of k that we have already calculated into 1000, which gives you 88.6 gram. So even after 1000 years, 88.6 gram will be left. Now we will do another interesting example. It says that in 1988, the Vatican authorized the British Museum to date a cloth relic known as Shroud of Turing, possibly the burial shroud of Jesus of Nazareth. This cloth, which surfaced in 1956, contains the negative image of human body that was widely believed to be that of Jesus. The report of the British Museum showed that the fibers in the cloth contain 92% and 93% of their original carbon 14. Now use this information to estimate the age of the shroud. So for solving this, what we need to do is that if we write the equation, you can see that I have just rewritten y naught was written over here. If we see the fraction of the remaining amount divided by the initial amount, I will get this. Now if I take log both the side, I will get, and I take out time, I will get this. Now according to the question, it was found that the cloth contained 92% to 93% of the original carbon 14. So we will use this information and we will put this because the fraction is 92 to 93%. So I have put over here as 93%. So I am getting time approximately 600 years, and then if I put it as 92%, that is 0.92, we will get 689. So an interesting observation is there that if we are doing the test in 1988, that means, and our analysis is showing that Schrodt is this much old, that is 600 to 689 year old. So that means that the cloth should be in around 1299 AD or 1388 AD. And if one accepts the validity of carbon 14 dating, the Schrodts of Turin cannot be the burial Schrodt of Jesus of Nazareth. So we get an interesting conclusion if we accept the validity of carbon 14 dating. So this was all about the exponential growth model. We will see how this exponential growth model was reformed with the other models, other growth models, in our next lecture. Thank you.